pharmacological activity of optical isomers of racemic drugs often differs in the human body, since the body itself is chiral. Where one optical isomer may be beneficial, the other may be harmful or even deadly. Thus, separation of these racemic mixtures has become a priority for pharmaceutical companies. However, purification systems for the production of single enantiomer drugs can be challenging and expensive. Therefore, millions of people with so-called orphan diseases find potential medicines de-emphasized by pharma companies due to the unfavorable rates of return on some of these orphan drugs. The goals of this project are to significantly speed up the process and lower the cost involved in developing chromatographic systems for chiral separations. I'd like to give just a brief review of chirality. I know most of you are very familiar with this. But a molecule is chiral if it has a non-superimposable mirror image. The classic example that you see is with the right and the left hand. In the picture I show here, in the left hand, you see a generic representation of an amino acid. Its mirror image in the right hand, you see. Now, labeling the optical isomers, we use the RNS system, which determines the substituent priority based upon the atomic number of the atom nearest the carbon in this case. For example, if we look at the molecule in the left hand, and let's rotate it so that the hydrogen is pointed in to the plane of the screen. That will bring the R group rotating 90 degrees out. Now, the R group represents the bulk of the amino acid. This could be another carbon with an aromatic ring, whatever, but generally it's the bulkiest part of the molecule, okay? Now, looking at that molecule, the substituent order is nitrogen before the carbon that's attached to a double bond, which is before a carbon attached to a carbon bond, which will be before the proton. So the proton's the lowest, it goes in the back. We rotate the molecule in the left hand, so now the R group goes 90 degrees, and basically it's like my arm's hydrogen and my three fingers represent the groups. So, looking at the molecule in the bottom right, the order would be amino, the acid, and then that carbon, or the R group. That's counterclockwise, that would be defined as S. So that's the S enantiomer or S optical isomer. Now, a few definitions. A chiral molecule, they come in pairs that are called optical isomers or enantiomers or mirror images. The terms are used interchangeably. A racemate is an equal mixture of enantiomers. Chirality is a three-dimensional effect. Thus, chiral recognition requires at least 3 points of interaction. And we'll look at that in more detail on a subsequent slide. Now, in chromatography, chiral discrimination is the ability of a chiral host to separate the two enantiomers of a mixture. Now, the properties of optical isomers. Well, they have the same molecular weight, the same shape, the same structure, connectivity among all the atoms, same melting point, density, solubility, energy, same everything. So when are they not the same? Well, when they're in the human body. Remember, the human body is chiral. When they're in animals or plants, or an HPLC chiral stationary phase called a CSP that's been prepared using a single optical isomer. And if we look in the lower left, we see a depiction of a chiral column, and this only has the R isomer in it. Let's say we take a mixture of optical isomers, R and S, and we place it on the top of the column and elute it. Looking at the energy of interaction between the R column and the racemate, if the RR interaction, that is between the R's of the column and the R of the racemate, is equal to the RS interaction, then we have no chiral discrimination. However, if the RR interaction is different than the RS interaction, then we can see chiral discrimination. This is the type of interaction that we'll be looking at with the molecular modeling when Ben Wu gets up and gives that part of the presentation. Now, there's a strong driving force for purifying optical isomers. And I have just four examples here. There are many examples in the market. Ibuprofen, for example, the S isomer is an anti-inflammatory. The R isomer has almost no effect. So basically, you're wasting half your material. If you can racemize that, then do another separation and recover the S isomer from that, you can see you can ultimately get all your product. Otherwise, 50% is lost. Looking at naproxen, the R isomer is used for arthritis pain. However, the S isomer is a teratogenic compound. Looking at thalidomide, now this is a classic example of what can happen. In the late 1950s, this was a drug that was prescribed for pregnant women to combat morning sickness. It's now used for treating certain cancers. What they found was that the S isomer caused horrendous birth defects. The US FDA prevented this compound from being sold in the US, so give them a cheer. So, citalopram, the S isomer is an antidepressant, the R isomer is inactive. So again, we've lost half the material. And like I said, there are many examples in the literature that address this.